that they refer to this thing that I used to get confused when we started talking about it. They put ISO, they put colon 2005, there's BS 25999 and all kinds of names. I think Noemi was just telling me about one this morning and encouraging us to go for that one as well. So I said, okay, so long as it won't cost us too much. I said, it won't cost too much, so go for it. Okay. Today we'll just talk about some of these things here. I'll run through this fairly quickly so that we can have a more informal chat, because I know that while I'm presenting, some of you might not want to jump in with questions. I think I'll do it very quickly so that you can ask all the questions that you want. We have a bit of time. So I'll talk about the concept, I'll talk about the structure we adopted. I'll give a little bit of, if you like, theoretical information about how we understand ISO 27001. We'll talk about our approach, the process, we'll talk about some of the challenges that we faced, conclusion, and then if I can presume to make recommendations to experts like yourselves, I will attempt to do so at the end. So let's quickly just talk about the concept itself. This is what I think that most of us perhaps would have read and so on and so forth. But before I talk about this, let me just tell you how we and I understand ISO 27001. For us as a bank, we saw it as a way to improve our processes, a way to move from a situation where I think that we were basically ordinary in goods to what I would class now to be moving towards best practice. It's not completely there, you must understand. The ISO is really just one stage in the journey, and it's a continuous journey. It really never ends, unfortunately. So, you know, if you think that by achieving ISO 27001, you've reached the end of the road, it doesn't get to the end of the road. There are new standards and new practices that are coming up all the time. And therefore, it's something that you just have to keep on working with best practice. On my board, I think we were making a presentation once, and every time I make a presentation on IT, you know, every member of the board sort of does like that, because they think that we're going to spend a lot of money. And then one day I was asked, you know, when are we going to stop spending money on IT? I couldn't believe it. I mean, it's not everybody that asks that kind of question, but there are one or two people who are particularly cost conscious. So they tell you that, what are you doing? And I said, we will never stop, unfortunately. Or fortunately. Fortunately, because if you never stop, it means that you're making progress. And then unfortunately, because you know, we would like to save money too, you know, but IT is expensive. You know, even though there are all sorts of efforts to make it cheaper. But I don't think you IT professionals will ever allow it to be cheap enough, you know, for us to actually make money off you. You know, so I think that it's good. So I can see some gentlemen who are specialists here smiling and saying this, because I know that there are quite a lot of consultants here. So I speak to all of us, you know, because I used to be a consultant myself. So the concept itself is basically it's a formal set of specifications for information security management. It's also a risk management tool, incidentally. And just in case we think that this is just for banks, it's not just for banks, it's for anybody who wants to achieve a certain level of information security management. I think we're just discussing this morning, and Ray was saying that I think Galaxy Backbone is getting certified in about a month's time or so.
They're certified,
but they'll be receiving their own presentation in a month's time. So anybody really that needs to be information security conscious, you know, can seek this certification, and it does a lot of things for you, which we'll talk about later. That one is a bit more complicated. Okay. It stipulates how information should be managed through its life cycle, and we will see the life cycle as we talk. talk this morning. It guides you on the controls to adopt for your organization. So it's not exclusively for any particular type of organization. You need to tailor it to your own type of organization. It brings information security under management control. Very important, because I mean, when you're talking about security and risk management and so on, really you're talking about management. Because those are the people that need to control those features. It's a process as well as a culture. A culture because, you know, as soon as you get certified, you really cannot go back to the way you used to do things. And I mean this very, very seriously. And I'll give you a very basic example, which perhaps you probably would not think about. When we were getting certified, the auditor, you know, came into our premises, and he was reviewing the registers that the security men have, you know, for cars that drive in and so on and so forth. And he asked the security men whether every car that had driven in was registered. And of course they said, yes, every car is registered. So he said, okay. And he pointed to one car and said, show me. And then everybody became frantic. Because, you know, this is the one of the most basic kinds of control. And it falls under assets control. You know, anything that is coming into the premises is supposed to be registered. You know, and for very good reason. I mean, the most extreme reason being that maybe it was the car that brought in the bomb. You know, just, I mean, that's an extreme case. But really, truly, there are all kinds of reasons, and you can imagine why you need to register assets that come into your premises. Okay. Let's take the next one. Now, this is the ISO structure. I remember when I first saw this, and I was told that there were 11, you know, basic tenets, and then 133 controls. And I said to Lars and Dwayne and Desmond, I could. You mean we're going to invest more on top of all the controls we already have? You know, and they said, no, that it's not quite like that. That you first of all, you have to take the ones that are relevant to you, and then you have to also practice them. It's more a matter of how you practice them than just the fact that you have the control, because you can have the control without actually practicing it, without actually implementing the practical side of it. So we then decided to, you know, we did. So, you know, if you look at it, there are basically 11 domains, as they call them. And these domains are, you know, security policy, the organization of information security, asset management, human resources, physical and environmental security. I touched on just now when I was talking about accessing to your premises. One of the things we had to do when we were implementing ISO was to cordon off where our generator was. I'm very certain that most of us here have a generator that is completely accessible to anybody and everybody. And therefore, if somebody wants to sabotage your operations, all he has to do is to go and do something to your generator. And as you know, you have very little power anyway. And therefore, once they sabotage your generator, especially for an institution that is reliant on power, you're finished. You can't work for the day. In the bank, I remember that a year ago or so, there was a day that we had. The two generators went down, and NEPA went down. So can you imagine a bank without power? Absolutely impossible. I think that was what led us to start working on the power farm, which is another aspect, incidentally, of ISO 27001. But you wouldn't see it that way. We started that one about a year, 2 years ago. But you can see now that all these things fit in to a total picture. You have things like access control, communications and operations management, even acquisition of your infrastructure. It's all part of the domains that you have in ISO. Incident management, okay? I mean, why would you want to plant incident information management. Because you need to know what's happening. You know, it's by collating this information that you're able to manage future incidents. Because if you record and record how you resolve a particular incident, you find it easier to deal with similar incidents in future. But if you have no record of those incidents, the next time it happens, it will just come as a surprise. You know, I used to have a managing director who used to always say that whenever he sees the staff, in those days an account officer, because that's where I was in corporate banking then, that whenever he sees an account officer who is surprised at anything that happens with the customer, he knows that he doesn't have a good account officer. You're supposed to know what is happening. You're supposed to plan, you're supposed to study, you're supposed to research, so that you get to expect certain things. And that's really when you're on top of risk management. When you begin to have a situation where you are almost able to predict the kind of things that can happen, then you've reached the level of risk management that is usually described as best practice. We have business continuity management, and then compliance is the final domain there. There are 133 controls, but I won't bore you by even talking about any of them. There are things which are, you know, they're all related to, you know, these items that you can see here, and they're all related to these domains. And when you decide to implement ISO 27001, you basically do an assessment which enables you to see what your scope will be, enables you to determine what kinds of controls you need to concentrate on. You know, because you're not going to need to do 133 of them. I can see people from insurance, I can see people from consulting, I can see people who do all kinds of logistics work here. You will all have very different, you know, aspects of these 133 controls or even the domains to concentrate on. And largely, that is how you determine the scope of your own ISO 27001 certification. Okay, let's go to the next one.
Sorry.
Yes. Sorry. You want to? Let's put it back.
Yes.
Okay, so back, please.
I'm
happy to get away from this.
This pyramid structure.
Yes.
You have to follow these on this.
No, not necessarily. Not necessarily. It's the structure that ISO has, and to a certain extent, it's fairly logical because the security policy is obviously number one.
Sure.
Because at the end of the day, that's really what you're working on. It's a information security management, and therefore the security policy is clearly the overriding control or the overriding domain. Does that help? Okay, great. Go on. Okay, now, properties of information. This is fairly straightforward, because remember we're still talking about information security, and these are the properties of information. I challenge anybody to show me any other property of information. No. I mean, that's not a serious one. I know some of you will say move your piece. When we finish this lecture, you can challenge me on the way out. I can tell you that I have a meeting to attend. So I'll give my phone number and you can call me and we can talk about it. But anyway, confidentiality. Obviously, ensuring that information is accessible only to those who are authorized to have access. Very basic, but often abused in our environment. Always abused in our environment. I mean, how many times do you find that information that should not have gotten somewhere has gotten to the places where it shouldn't? Okay? And we're all guilty of it, unfortunately. I suspect every one of us here gives out information not knowing that we've even given out the kind of information that we shouldn't give out. And you know, what this kind of standard does is to bring it home to you and make it part of your second nature. Okay. By the time you've gone through the processes required for this kind of certification, your thinking will change completely. You're not likely to just do things, you know, the way that, you know, you would ordinarily just do them. You're not likely to just answer questions that are posed to you without thinking about what the implications are. It takes a while, but it's, you know, like I said, it's a process that you really have to, you know, work through. Integrity. Basically, integrity, you know, for an accountant, of course, is the accuracy and completeness of the information, as well as the methods by which you process that information. You know, of course, for a bank, it's very easy to see why you require integrity. We have customers, and we simply have to confidentiality. We have to have integrity. We have to be able to, you know, say that when we charge you interest, that the figures are absolutely correct.